ചരിത്രം, പുരാവസ്തുശാസ്ത്രം, ഇതര സാമൂഹ്യശാസ്ത്ര വിഷയങ്ങൾ എന്നിവയിൽ ഗവേഷണാധിഷ്ഠിതമായ പ്രതിബദ്ധത നിലനിർത്തുന്ന ഒരു സ്വയംഭരണ ഗവേഷണ സ്ഥാപനമാണ് കേരള ചരിത്ര ഗവേഷണ കൗൺസിൽ. വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ വകുപ്പിൻ്റെ സമ്പൂർണ്ണ ധനസഹായത്തോടുകൂടി പ്രവർത്തിക്കുന്ന സ്ഥാപനമാണ് KCHR. സ്ഥാപനത്തിൻ്റെ പ്രധാന ഓഫീസും റിസർച്ച് ലൈബ്രറിയും തിരുവനന്തപുരത്തുള്ള വൈലോപ്പിള്ളി സംസ്കൃതി ഭവനിൽ സ്ഥിതി ചെയ്യുന്നു. പ്രളയം, ചരിത്രരേഖകളും ഓർമ്മകളും, ഡിജിറ്റൈസിംഗ് കേരളാസ് പാസ്റ്റ്, പട്ടണം പുരാവസ്തു ഗവേഷണം, കൺസർവേഷൻ ഓഫ് ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ ഹെറിറ്റേജ് ഓഫ് കേരള, ചരിത്രാന്വേഷണ യാത്രകൾ, കുടുംബചരിത്രം, ജീവചരിത്രം, പ്രാദേശിക ചരിത്രം എന്നിവ ഉൾപ്പെടുന്ന ആർക്കൈവ് രൂപീകരണം, വാമൊഴി ചരിത്ര പദ്ധതികൾ, പഞ്ചായത്ത് വിജ്ഞാനീയം തുടങ്ങി ഉന്നത അക്കാദമിക നിലവാരം പുലർത്തുന്ന വിവിധ ഗവേഷണ പദ്ധതികളോടൊപ്പം സാമൂഹ്യശാസ്ത്രങ്ങളിലുള്ള വ്യത്യസ്ത സെമിനാറുകളും ശില്പശാലകളും KCHR പ്രവർത്തന പരിധിയിൽ ഉൾപ്പെടുന്നു. KCHR ഏറ്റവും പുതിയ സംരംഭമാണ് കേരള സമൂഹത്തിൻ്റെ പരിണാമം എന്ന വിഷയത്തെ അടിസ്ഥാനമാക്കിയുള്ള പ്രഭാഷണ പരമ്പര. സെക്കൻഡറി തലം മുതൽ ബിരുദാനന്തര തലം വരെയുള്ള വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളെ മുന്നിൽ കണ്ടുകൊണ്ട് ഓൺലൈൻ വിദ്യാഭ്യാസ പ്രക്രിയയിൽ കേരള ചരിത്ര സംബന്ധിയായ സമഗ്രവും വിമർശനാത്മകവുമായ അറിവ് വിദ്യാർത്ഥികളിൽ എത്തിക്കാൻ ഉതകുന്നതായിരിക്കും ഈ പ്രഭാഷണ പരമ്പര. കേരള ചരിത്ര രചനയിൽ സ്വന്തം ഇടപെടലുകൾ കൊണ്ട് വ്യക്തിമുദ്ര പതിപ്പിച്ച പണ്ഡിതരാണ് പ്രഭാഷണങ്ങൾ നടത്തുന്നത്. വർത്തമാനകാലം ഭൂതകാലവുമായി സംവദിക്കുമ്പോഴാണ് ചരിത്ര രചന സംഭവിക്കുന്നത്. ഗണിതവും ശാസ്ത്രവും ഭാഷയും പഠിക്കാൻ എന്ന പോലെ ചരിത്ര പഠനത്തിനും രചനയ്ക്കും ഒരു രീതിശാസ്ത്രമുണ്ട്. ഭൂതകാലം ഇട്ടയച്ചു പോയ തെളിവ് സാമഗ്രികളെ വ്യാഖ്യാനിക്കുമ്പോൾ ഭിന്ന അഭിപ്രായങ്ങളുണ്ടാവും. അവ ചരിത്ര ഗവേഷണ കൗൺസിലിൻ്റെ ഔദ്യോഗിക അഭിപ്രായങ്ങളല്ല, അവ തികച്ചും പ്രഭാഷകൻ്റേത് മാത്രമാണ്. സംവാദങ്ങളിലൂടെ സമന്വയത്തിലെത്തുക എന്നതാണ് കൗൺസിലിൻ്റെ നയം.
നമസ്കാരം. ഇന്ന് പേപ്പർ അവതരിപ്പിക്കുന്നത് പ്രൊഫസർ അജിത് കുമാർ. ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ സർവേ ഓഫ് ഇന്ത്യയിൽ 1984 ഔദ്യോഗിക ജീവിതം ആരംഭിച്ചു. 1997 കേരള സർവകലാശാലയിലെ പുരാവസ്തു വകുപ്പിന്റെ സ്ഥാപക മേധാവിയായി ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെന്റ് കൗൺസിൽ ചെയർമാൻ, ഡോക്ടറൽ കമ്മിറ്റി ചെയർമാൻ, ബോർഡ് ഓഫ് സ്റ്റഡീസ്, സ്കൂൾ ഓഫ് സോഷ്യൽ സയൻസ് ഡയറക്ടർ എന്നീ നിലകളിൽ സേവനമനുഷ്ഠിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. 2020 ആർക്കിയോളജി വിഭാഗം മേധാവിയായിരിക്കെ 35 മികച്ച സേവന അനുഭവങ്ങളുമായി ഔദ്യോഗിക ജീവിതത്തിൽ നിന്നും വിരമിച്ചു. പുരാവസ്തു സംബന്ധിയായ നിരവധി ഉത്ഖനനങ്ങളിലും പര്യവേഷണങ്ങളിലും സജീവ പങ്കാളിത്തം ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. വിവിധ ജേണലുകളിലും പുസ്തകങ്ങളിലുമായി 100 ഗവേഷണ പ്രബന്ധങ്ങൾ പ്രസിദ്ധീകരിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. പുരാവസ്തുശാസ്ത്രവും വിഷയവുമായി ബന്ധപ്പെട്ട 9 ഗ്രന്ഥങ്ങളുടെ കർത്താവ് കൂടിയാണ് ഡോക്ടർ അജിത് കുമാർ. സർ, സ്വാഗതം. സർ,
താങ്ക് യു. ഹലോ.
Yes, sir.
Okay. At the outset, I thank KCHR and its team, especially Dr. Karthikeyan sir, Targan sir, Fasia, who invited me to this lecture. Thank you one and all. So I start my presentation now. I hope it's there on the screen.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So starting. Thank you once again to KCHR and its team. Today, my topic of discussion is principles and methods in archaeology and glimpses of some work done in Kerala by me and our department in Kerala University. What is archaeology? The word archaeology is derived from two Greek words, Archaeos meaning ancient and logy means study. So in essence, it's the study, archaeology is the study of human past, and history too is a study of human past. But there is subtle difference between archaeology and history. So in order to understand the past, archaeology relies on the study of tangible cultural artifacts or vestiges collected through specific principles and methods devised for the subject. History, on the other hand, relies and bases its study on written records left by mankind on stone, terracotta, metal, papyrus, or paper. Archaeology in varina word rendu Greek word inana eduthirikkana. Archaeos means ancient, logy means a systematic study. Archaeology is the study of human past, material remains, cultural artifacts in the study aanu adu oru systematic aayittulla oru explorationum excavationum polatha sambhavangalil ninnu collect cheythu padikkunna oru artifacts padikkunna oru subject aanu archaeology. History മനുഷ്യൻ്റെ പഴമയെ കുറിച്ച് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ചരിത്രത്തെ കുറിച്ച് പഠിക്കുന്ന ഒരു സംഭവമാണ്. പക്ഷെ ചരിത്രം ഹിസ്റ്ററി ബേസിസ് ഇറ്റ്സ് റെക്കോർഡ്സ് ഓൺ റിട്ടൺ റെക്കോർഡ്സ്. റിട്ടൺ റെക്കോർഡ്സിൻ്റെ ബേസിസിലാണ് ഹിസ്റ്ററി സാധാരണ എഴുതപ്പെടുന്നത്. അത് ഒന്നിൽ ഈ സ്റ്റോണിൽ കിട്ടിയ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ടെറക്കോട്ടറിൽ മെറ്റൽ പേപ്പറസ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ പേപ്പറിൽ കിട്ടിയ എഴുതിയ സംഭവങ്ങൾ ഗ്രന്ഥങ്ങൾ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ എഴുതിയ എവിഡൻസസ് വെച്ചാണ് ഹിസ്റ്ററി പഠിക്കപ്പെടുന്നത്. ഇൻട്രസ്റ്റ് ഇൻ ആൻറ്റിക്വിറ്റി ഓഫ് ഹ്യൂമൻ പാസ്റ്റ്. ഹിസ്റ്ററിയെ പോലെ അത്രയും പഴമയുള്ള ഒരു സബ്ജക്റ്റ് അല്ല ആർക്കിയോളജി. എന്നെങ്കിൽ പോലും ഹിസ്റ്ററി, ഹ്യൂമൻ ഹിസ്റ്ററിയുടെ ഒരു ഒരു പാസ്റ്റിനെ കുറിച്ചുള്ളൊരു റെഫറൻസസ് പ്രീ ക്രിസ്ത്യൻ ഗ്രീക്ക് റോമൻ ലിറ്ററേച്ചർ അത് കുറച്ച് ചെറിയ തോതിൽ അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് അവൈലബിൾ ആണ്. അപ്പം ദർ ആർ ഇൻസ്റ്റൻസസ് ഓഫ് സം പീപ്പിൾ ഹു ഹവ് പെർസ്യൂഡ് ദിസ് ഡയറക്ഷൻ ആൻഡ് ട്രൈ ടു ഫൈൻഡ് ഔട്ട് ദ പ്രീ ക്രിസ്ത്യൻ ആൻഡ് ദ ആൻറ്റിക്വിറ്റി ഓഫ് മാൻകൈൻഡ്. സോ ഇതുപോലത്തെ ഒരു എംപറർ ആയിരുന്നു നെബോഡിയസ് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ ഒരു കിങ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഹി ലിവ്ഡ് ഇൻ 6th സെഞ്ചുറി BC ആൻഡ് ഹി വാസ് കിങ് ഓഫ് ന്യൂ ബാബിലോണിയൻ എംപയർ. ആൻഡ് ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് റെക്കോർഡഡ് ഇൻ ഇൻസ്ക്രിപ്ഷൻസ് ദാറ്റ് ഹി ഹാഡ് ആക്ച്വലി റീബിൽഡ് എ ടെമ്പിൾ ടു ദ മൂൺ ഗോഡ് സിൻ ഇൻ ഹിസ് എംപയർ. And this is probably the oldest record of somebody attempting to rebuild or reconstruct antiquarian structures or heritage structures which existed prior to their times and then bringing it to the then existing society. So Nabonidus is one king who lived in 6th century BC and attempted to renovate temple structures, especially a moon god where his mother was supposed to be a chief priestess, and he is supposed to have attempted to renovate that particular temple of moon god. And similarly, in the excavations at Ur in the palace complex of Nabonidus, it was found that antiquities were stored and racked and placed in a room in his palace, clearly like a museum. So the artifacts which are found in that particular palace complex were much more older than his period of time. So Nabonidus at least had this tendency of collecting artifacts and prior to his time period and collecting them and storing them and also probably trying to understand their significance. So Nabonidus is one peculiar king who lived in 6th century who could be stated to be as the founding person of museums and archaeological conservations as such. Now in all religions the theory about human creation of God, that is, in every religion we say that God created man, so God created human. So in many religion, because this is the understatement or this is a statement that is commonly found, nobody tried to question this particular belief, and so it was generally said that God created man, and so many people didn't think beyond this particular fact that man is created by God. But in times between 14th and 17th century in Europe, there was a period of Renaissance or Navodayathinte oru kalagattam undayirunnu 14th to 15th century 17th century kedake adu start cheythu Italyil aanengilum, but it spread over Europe and brought about intellectual and socio cultural and religious upheaval and awakening. So ee Navodayathinte bhagamayitte Europeile 14th to 17th century inde edake there was a period of Renaissance, and aa periodile ഇന്റലക്ച്വലും സോഷ്യലും കൾച്ചറലും റിലീജിയസുമായിട്ടുള്ളൊരു അപ്ഹീവലും അവേക്കനിങ്ങും ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. ഈ കാലഘട്ടത്തിൽ ഒരു 16th century ഒരു 17th century മിഡ് വരെയും ജീവിച്ചിരുന്ന ഒരു ഒരു ആർച്ച് ബിഷപ്പ് ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു, ജെയിംസ് ഉഷർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട്. ഇദ്ദേഹം അന്നത്തെ ക്രിസ്ത്യൻ ഫിലോസഫിയിലും ഉള്ള റെഫറൻസസും ബിബ്ലിക്കൽ സോഴ്സസിലൊക്കെ ഉള്ള മാൻ്റെ ക്രിയേഷനെ പറ്റിയുള്ള കഥകൾ വായിച്ച് അതിൻ്റെയൊക്കെ ഒരു ഉൽപ്പത്തി, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ വെൻ വാസ് മാൻ ക്രിയേറ്റഡ് അക്കോർഡിംഗ് ടു ദീസ് സോർട്ട് ഓഫ് ടെക്സ്റ്റുവൽ റെഫറൻസ് എന്നുള്ള ഒരു അന്വേഷണം നടത്തി. അദ്ദേഹം ജൂലിയൻ കലണ്ടറിന്റെ ആസ്പദമാക്കി ഹി സെഡ് ദാറ്റ് ഓൺ 23rd October 4004 BCE മനുഷ്യനെ ദൈവം സൃഷ്ടിച്ചതെന്ന് ഉള്ള ഒരു ഒരു തിയറി അദ്ദേഹം കൊണ്ടുവന്നു. സോ ഈ പല ആൾക്കാർക്കും എസ്പെഷ്യലി ഇൻ യൂറോപ്പ് വേർ ക്രിസ്ത്യാനിറ്റി വാസ് എ മേജർ റിലീജിയസ് ഫോൾ, ഈ 4004 BCE എന്ന് പറയുന്ന ഒരു നിർണായകമായ ഒരു പീരിയഡ് ആയിരുന്നു when actually man was created according to the calculations made by James Usher, who was a archbishop of Ireland. And in Middle Ages also there was whatever probe related to man's antiquity was done, it was all limiting to the factor of about 4004 BC, which was suggested by Usher. Now in period of Renaissance many of the things that are stated in religious texts remain unchallenged. And however, during the period of Renaissance, there was a revival of deep interest in Greco-Roman literature and also search for Greco-Roman sites with structural and sculptural artifacts. And this led to this particular revival of interest in Roman literature, Greco-Roman literature, and trying to locate ancient Roman sites which were abandoned. This led to discovery, rediscovery and documentations of many Greco-Roman sites in Greece, Italy, Ionia, etc. during the 18th century. So as part of the Renaissance movement in Europe, there was a keen interest for Greco-Roman literature and also trying to locate ancient abandoned Greco-Roman sites. And the antiquities and artifacts, especially sculptures and other element of art which were found from this site, were actually collected by elite of the society, and such artifacts used to be decorated there in their homes, and sometimes during weekends gathering were called up to admire such old artifacts which are collected from various sites. And eventually the surplus collections from the houses of these elites came to be stored and stacked in museum buildings for public display. And this space of interest in antiquities and collection of antiquities is called as a period of antiquarianism in Europe. And during the Renaissance period, there were also studies in astronomy, geology, paleontology, and evolution being conducted in Europe and elsewhere. And this also got strong during the 18th and 19th century. Many of the results of these studies started to be published. And many of the results that were emerging from the study of all these factors like astronomy, geology, and paleontology and evolution were actually challenging the existing beliefs that was expressed in religious thought. And what emerged from these scientific studies in other disciplines was also archaeology also tried to borrow some of these elements, because they also were interested in collection of artifacts, and the antiquity of artifacts extended much beyond the Greco-Roman period that was been found in various parts of Europe. And the studies emerging in these scientific subjects also brought about a scientific temperament in archaeology, and the movement of antiquarianism into a scientific discipline of archaeology started to emerge by around 18th and 19th century. In the 19th century, in 1830, Bushedi Pathas, he found flint implements along with fossil bones of elephant and rhinoceros in Saume Valley near Abbeville in France. And he placed them to Pleistocene period. This is Bushedi Pathas. And his discovery was widely published or widely reckoned in Europe and France, especially during that period. But there were also people who were speculative or who were not sure about the finds about Jacques-Vedi Pathas, because they felt that it is actually much more older than what was actually being thought about, the usual date was 4004 BC. So they found that some of these artifacts, which were actually found along with elephant and animal bones, Parthas said that these implements are man-made artifacts, and it was made by humans when these extinct elephant and rhinoceros were present in the Abbeville Valley. So that pushed the antiquity of these man-made structures or man-made items much beyond 4004 BC. So many people questioned what Bhushreti Parthas had to state by the finding of these flint implements from the Abbeville Valley in France. However, there were also geological studies being undertaken by Preservation Lilly, Charles Lilly in England during the time. And when this discovery became very prominent, Joseph Prestwich in 1859 visited Abbeville Valley, and he for the first time vouched that he authenticated that the finds of these artifacts by Bhushreti Parthas are in fact made by man and it is not a natural stone. And subsequently, Charles Lilly also visited the Abbeville Valley, and he studied these fossils and the layers in the river valley from where these implements were found. And he authenticated and he confirmed the stratigraphy of these implements as well as the fossil finds from Abbeville Valley. And he, in fact, vouched and authenticated Bhushreti Parthas' find as man-made implements in stone. So that pushed back the antiquity of a man. And during this period, like I had earlier said, during the period of antiquarianism, there was also, I said, the collections of which were initially in the mansions of the socially elite started pouring into museums also. And Danish Museum in Copenhagen received a lot of collections from the elite in different parts of Europe. And they were actually being housed in the museum, and the museum authorities decided to classify and catalog these artifacts which were actually in the possession of Danish Museum at Copenhagen. And they appointed C.J. Thomason as the first curator of the collections of the Northern Antiquities which were there in the museum. So his job was to analyze the collection and make it presentable to the public in general. So after the analysis of the collections in the museum, according to the tool making technologies which he observed, he divided the whole collections in the Northern Antiquity section into three broad periods, that is the Stone Age, Bronze Age and Iron Age. So he found that the Stone Age implements, which were also found in Abbeville, are definitely the earliest man-made artifacts, followed by Metal Age, which is actually represented by the Bronze Age, and followed by what is known as the Iron Age and the subsequent historical period. So Thomson was actually able to first bring in a classification in archaeology according to typology and chronology, that he was able to divide the whole period of man's existence in this universe into three periods according to the artifacts found: Stone Age, Bronze Age and Iron Age. And this particular system revolutionized archaeology and also brought out a systematic approach towards archaeology. And Thomason's classification of is known as also the 3-8 system, and it was first published in the book Guide to Northern Antiquities in 1848. And it is also during this period, in the mid of the 19th century, that Charles Darwin also came out with his theory of, or theory of natural selections. And he published his great masterpiece work, The Origin of Species and the Descent of Man, in 1871. The Origin of Species was published in 1859, and The Descent of Man was published finally in 1871. And these publications actually pushed back the antiquity of mankind to many, many thousands of years, because of the simple fact Darwin had advocated that man evolved from primates, and nobody was able to buy his theory or take his theory for granted. And that is how some of the cartoons depicting Darwin as a ape emerged in Europe. But however, it was subsequently proven by other studies also. Even Russell Wallace had actually come out with the same theory as Darwin even before him, and both of them together had published the initial paper in 1939 about theory of natural selection. And this I pushed back the antiquity of mankind even to many thousands of years. And when the antiquity of mankind was pushed by the works of Charles Darwin, there was also John Lubbock, a prehistorian who was working in Europe. He also made a systematic classification into the prehistoric period in Europe, and he brought out a book called Prehistoric Times in 1865, in which he divided the whole prehistoric phase into two broad phases, namely Paleolithic or Old Stone Age and another lithic stage called Neolithic or New Stone Age. Now, with these sort of classifications coming into four, especially the three age system and the classification of prehistory into Paleolithic and Neolithic, cultural vestiges from a whole array of time period came into be considered by archaeologists. First would be the prehistoric period, which represents a period where right from the time man evolved in the universe as humans and till the time period when written records came into existence. So the earliest written records if you consider the whole world itself, they are not more than 5,200 years old. So you can imagine, about 5 million years ago when man came into existence, and 5,000 years before present when the first writing evidences we get. So to the 99% of human existence, we have no written records, and it is solely represented by artifacts, and archaeological study of these artifacts is the only means to understand 99% of human unwritten history. And with further classification of this particular prehistoric period, we will go into it. But in Europe as generally, it is we have only two broad classifications, the prehistoric period and the historic period. So historic period commences with written evidences emerging, and prehistoric emerges before the writing period. But in the Indian context, we have a middle phase known as proto-historic period. It's a beginning of historical period. So now this particular period, proto-historic period, is basically when we do have written records available with us, but they have not been conclusively deciphered, or there is no unanimous opinion regarding the decipherment of this early scripts, and hence it is placed in the proto-historic. And the Harappan cultural period in India would represent the proto-historic period of India, where we have written records, but they have not been properly or unanimously approved of in its reading. So that would be the proto-historic. Then coming to the historic, and now coming to the prehistoric period, which is also known as the Stone Age or the Paleolithic era. This is essentially there are, according to the tool typology that is available from the prehistoric period, it has been the lower Paleolithic, middle Paleolithic, and upper Paleolithic is the broad classification which have been brought on Paleolithic period or Paleolithic era. That is a Paleolithic phase ennu parayna allengi old stone age ennu parayna phase il further aayittu divisions kondu vannittu adine lower, middle, upper Paleolithic ennulla oru classification kuda kondu vannittund. Appa ee lower Paleolithic, middle Paleolithic, upper, lower would be the earliest, middle nadakkulladum, upper Paleolithic ennum ettum Paleolithic il ettum latest aayittulladum aayirikkum upper Paleolithic ennulla phase parayunu. അപ്പൊ ഈ ലോവർ പാലിയോലിത്തിക്കും മിഡിൽ പാലിയോലിത്തിക്കും അപ്പർ പാലിയോലിത്തിക്കും കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് വരുന്ന ഒരു പീരീഡിനെ നമ്മൾ മീസോലിത്തിക് എന്നാണ് വിളിക്കുന്നത്. ആൻഡ് മീസോലിത്തിക് പീരീഡിലും ഇസ് ഫോളോഡ് ബൈ ദ ന്യൂലിത്തിക് ഓർ ദ ന്യൂ സ്റ്റോൺ ഏജ്. അപ്പൊ ഈ ക്ലാസിഫിക്കേഷൻസ് മുഴുവൻ വരുന്നത് ലിത്തിക് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് നമ്മൾ ഉപയോഗിക്കുന്നത്, ലിത്തിക് എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ സ്റ്റോൺ ടൂൾസ് എന്നാണ് മീനിങ് വരുന്നത്. അപ്പൊ സ്റ്റോൺ ടൂൾസിന്റെ വെറൈറ്റിയും ടൈപ്പോളജിയും അനുസരിച്ചാണ് നമ്മൾ ഈ പാലിയോലിത്തിക് മിസോലിത്തിക് നിയോലിത്തിക് എന്നുള്ള ക്ലാസിഫിക്കേഷൻസ് കൊണ്ടുവരുന്നത് ദർ ആർ ഓൾസോ അതർ ക്യാരക്ടറിസ്റ്റിക്സ് അപ്പാർട്ട് ഫ്രം ദ സ്റ്റോൺ ഇംപ്ലിമെന്റ്സ് ദാറ്റ് ആർ ഫൗണ്ട് ദീസ് കൾച്ചറൽ പീരിയഡ്സ് ഓർ ഇൻ ദീസ് ഡിഫറെന്റ് ഫേസസ് വിച്ച് യു ഹവ് നോട്ടീസ്ഡ് ആൻഡ് ദ നിയോലിത്തിക് ഈസ് ഓൾസോ എ പീരിയഡ് വെൻ it is the human habitation starts to become they start settling in one place and they also take into agriculture and also domestication of plants and animals. So Neolithic is sometimes called as a revolutionary period in as far as mankind is concerned because of this tendency to settle, start agriculture and domestication. Now the Neolithic stage is followed by the Bronze Age in the European context and in the and the Chalcolithic period in the Indian context. Chalco means copper, lithic means tool. So the Chalcolithic defines a phase where both copper and lithic tools have been used. So that falls into the Indian context. The Chalcolithic is an Indian nomenclature rather than the Bronze Age which is used in Europe. So the Harappan civilization is basically a Chalcolithic culture, but it shows characteristics of urban civilization also. Now the historical period, I said, as written records are available, and the earliest written records do not go back more than 5200 years before present. So in the Indian context, the earliest writing only emerged by around 4th century BC, 5th century BC, that's the maximum time period which we assign to written records in Indian context. Now, this is a picture of the Paleolithic and implements. These are the implements which are known as hand axes, and these hand axes and cleaver is a typical tool typology of Lower Paleolithic. These are the tool types of Middle Paleolithic, which are basically scrapers, borers, points. These are the typology which are essentially tools which are made on flake, and this is the essential character of. They are actually smaller in size than the Lower Paleolithic implements, and essentially made on blades. Now, Upper Paleolithic is the industry which is characterized by blade and burine. So, blades are actually longer when compared to flakes. Flakes are generally considered to be broader in its main length, and this is followed. The Upper Paleolithic is followed by Mesolithic, which are actually blade and bladelets have been used in this thing. You might wonder how these small implements could have been used as tools, but these small implements were actually hafted into bone or wood and then used as a combined effort and combined tool. These are the typical Neolithic cells, which is ground polished and ground pegged polished implements, which are known as Neolithic cell. As I stated earlier, it also it starts with the period of domestication of and cultivation. So you have other saddle cones and pottery, because when you start cultivating, and then you also need spaces for storage, so that also eventually led to handmade pottery and finally wheel made pottery, and hence all these factors emerging we call that Neolithic period is also in a way revolutionary in its aspect. So now in the Kerala context, we do not find prehistoric material, especially Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic, Upper Paleolithic. Very stray reportings have been there, but some of these are still debated upon. So the most visible monument when you come up about in prehistoric structures, or when we can consider Kerala, megaliths or Mahashila Yugathinte megaliths ennu parayunna sambhavangalana ethum visible aayittulla nammal kaanunna monumental structures, palamaeriya structures, and because of its easy visibility, the earliest studies even in India probably were undertaken in Kerala on megaliths, and in 1823 John Babington discovered and excavated Chattaparamba, and he brought out the new facets which were noticed in megaliths. And today there are almost 7 well-defined type of megaliths, and some of the excavated ones have yielded dates close to 1000 BC. So earlier, you know, these typologically, the variant ones, cyst, horn burials, menhir, dolmen, kodakal, and rocket cells, and then topical. So there are many varieties now, seven at least well-defined varieties, and some of them going back to even 1000 BC. So we never had a date of 1000 BC. When earlier studies were conducted in megaliths, we had thought it would date close to historical period. The other most visible structure, which was never lost in the prehistoric context in Kerala, used to be rock art. And one of the earliest rock art sites to be explored in Tamilagam as such was Edakkal by Fessert in 1890. And he made a detailed report on this find, even covering its anthropological aspect, and published it in Indian Antiquary in 1901. And today there are more than 40 signs bearing pictographs and petroglyphs known in Kerala. And two books regarding it have been published, one by Madhpal in 1997, and another one recently covering 30 signs has been published by me, titled Petroglyphs and Pictographs of Kerala or Rock Art in Kerala. So this was one in prehistoric thing that struck interest in European savants who had, especially in Malabar region after the defeat of Tipu, when British came to occupy the Malabar region, they ventured into studying all these archaeological artifacts and antiquarian artifacts, especially prehistoric only we would know of. The ones on the megaliths and the rock art. A few microliths also were reported initially, but no detailed study have been published by the British savants who had found them from Chevayur. So these are the basic things of prehistoric studies that have been undertaken in the early part of the late part of the 19th, the early part of the 20th century. Now, explorations in a defined manner. Now, these, as I stated, some of these things were earlier visible on the ground, so they could be taken up for excavations. But systematic explorations for trying to find out new archaeological sites or artifacts can be termed as explorations. So, explorations can be divided into, you know, broadly into two. One is the problem-oriented explorations, or random specific area. So problem oriented exploration is something when you're looking for a specific specific object or a specific culture and in a particular area. Like for example, after the partition, many of the major well-known Harappan sites had gone into Pakistan. So then after the independence, there was a random problem oriented explorations to try and locate Harappan sites or Harappan cultural site or Indus related cultural sites, Harappan cultural sites within the Indian boundary. So these are some of the problem-oriented thing. It could be even problem-oriented. Could be also even in megalithics. It could be in forts. It could be in historical elements. It could be in trade. It could be in rock art. It could be any specific problem-oriented explorations towards understanding any facet of archaeology would come under, you know, a problem-oriented survey. But in both the cases, whether it is problem-oriented or a random-specific area-oriented, random-specific oriented would be that you are taking a small locality, probably a village in a taluk, exploring it, and then trying to find out what is that artifacts or antiquarian things that you've been able to locate within that specific area of a village or a taluk or a district and things like that. So that would be random specific area oriented. But in both the cases, it's advisable that you understand the previous work done in the region. In the exploration, in the archaeology, in the facets, in the archaeological explorations, in the archaeology, but the problem is കാര്യമായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ മനസ്സിലാക്കിക്കൊണ്ട് വേണം ഒരു എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ ഇറക്കാൻ. അത് റാൻഡമായിട്ട് ചെയ്യുന്ന എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ ആയെങ്കിലും അവിടെ ഇതിനു മുമ്പ് ചെയ്തിരിക്കുന്ന വസ്തുതകൾ എന്താണ്, അവിടെ നിന്ന് കിട്ടിയിരിക്കുന്ന മെറ്റീരിയൽ എന്താണെന്ന് നമ്മൾ അറിഞ്ഞിരിക്കണം. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മൾ പുതിയത് ആയിട്ട് കണ്ടുപിടിച്ചു അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കണ്ടെത്തി എന്ന് വിചാരിക്കുന്ന സാധനം ചിലപ്പോൾ ഇതിനു മുമ്പ് തന്നെ ആൾക്കാർ കണ്ടെത്തി അതിനെപ്പറ്റി പബ്ലിക്കേഷൻസ് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടാവാം, അല്ലെങ്കിൽ അതിനെപ്പറ്റി റിപ്പോർട്ട് ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ടാവും. അപ്പം നമ്മൾ ചെയ്ത വർക്ക് പിന്നെ അതിന് പ്രസക്തി ഇല്ലാതാവും. അതുകൊണ്ട് ഈ ചെയ്ത വർക്കിനെ കുറിച്ച് ആദ്യം ആധികാരികമായിട്ട് പഠിച്ചിട്ട് വേണം ഒരു പിന്നെ ഒരു പുതിയതായിട്ടൊരു പ്രോബ്ലം ഓറിയൻ്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ ചെയ്യാനായിട്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ നമ്മൾ കണ്ടക്ട് ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ സൈറ്റ്സ് ഡിറ്റക്ട് ചെയ്യാനാണ്, കൾച്ചറൽ വെസ്റ്റേജസ് ഡിറ്റക്ട് ചെയ്യാനാണെന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു. അപ്പോൾ അത് നമ്മൾ ചെയ്യുമ്പോൾ ഒന്നിലീ വെർച്വലായിട്ട് നമ്മൾ ആക്ച്വലി ഒരു സൈറ്റിൽ നടന്നുകൊണ്ട് വി ആർ മൂവിങ് അറൌണ്ട് ഇൻ ദ സൈറ്റ് ലുക്കിംഗ് ഫോർ ആക്ച്വലി ആർട്ടിഫാക്ട്സ് or certain structures or vestiges around that particular area. So that is actually when you are actually field walking and then virtually trying to survey and find out if something is available. Another is using some scientific methods or scientific implements that also you can use or you can do archaeological exploration. So the virtual or actual archaeological exploration is achieved, as I said, through field walking in visual inspection of the site. And in this particular thing, you are looking out for artifacts or features which are visible in the site. And this can be also achieved through scientific aids. Now, what are the factors when you look forward exploration? Because if you're going to any exploration to a site, like I said, it's mandatory that you know the previous work done in the discovery. In a region, and it is also necessary that you understand the geology and geography of the terrain in which you are trying to explore, because of the simple fact geology and geography determines the nature of the culture that can be found in that particular region. Hence, you have to understand the geology and geomorphology of the geography and geomorphology of the terrains which you are trying to explore, because many of these habitation sources will be close to water sources. So also, if there are implements to be made, you are also looking for geological material where the implements could be made on. So that is why I said geology and geography of the terrain in which you are trying to take up the explorations is to be understood well before taking up any explorations. And when you are looking for something, it's not that always all the archaeological structures are actually lost over the period of time. Now, if you go to certain places, you can see some of the structures right existing from 3,000 and 2,000 years old structures visible on the surface, undisturbed, because the area is some totally barren and not habited. Those structures remain in situ at the site. So, in the true sense, some features and structures are never lost. Lost that they have to be discovered and things like that. Many of these things which we perceive as lost or we think as discovery are sometimes already known to the locals. So it is best to interact with the local residents of the area to understand the myths, legend, oral history of the region we are trying to take up for exploration, and they can actually act as a guide to us in locating ancient things close to their habitations or close to their villages. So it's best that you interact with also the local people, because we will arrive there as an external person. So the locals would be aware of the things better than what we know of. If we have preliminary done a study into the previous works, we would also be able to understand what is available in the broadened areas of that particular locales. When you're looking for in a problem oriented explorations, you might be looking for a particular structure or a particular artifact. It could be prehistoric, it could be megalithic, it could be neolithic or whatever. But in that search, if you're coming across other archaeological artifacts or archaeological vestiges or archaeological features, it would be also interesting to record them, photograph them, draw them if possible. Also, with latitude longitudinal specifications, is to do have a lot of technical GPS is easily available where you can record them with gradients, and you can also interact with locals and try to bring about the importance of that particular structure and why it should be retained in this. For example, in many parts of Kerala, 20 years back, some sites were reported in the Indian Archaeological Review and things like that. But today, if you go to the site, it is not there. And similarly, in Attapadi, area, hundreds of acres were scattered with megalithic monuments. But today, if you go there, you do not notice much of the megalithic structure which were earlier reported. So at least reporting, photography and recording of these structures, even if they are not pertaining totally to the area of research, it will be a record for the posterity. Now, sites can be of primary or secondary nature when you are looking for. So in an habitation site can be abandoned due to natural or man-made calamity, and during this process the site falling into disuse starts to disintegrate, and the biodegradable fauna and flora merges with the mud, and non-biodegradable materials like pottery, stone items, baked bricks, charred remains, etc. remain in the site. And both these together, the biodegradable and degradable material, they remain in the site in a form of a heap, which in color and composition will be different from the ground soil that is surrounding it. And since Kerala is very thickly populated and thickly vegetated, many of these features which I'm talking about right now might not be immediately visible to you. In certain areas where there was a cluster habitation, maybe we will be able to notice. But in Kerala, the tendency has generally been for about scattered habitation, like we have even today, that individual plots are there, and we live in individual plots. So that scattered habitation would not create a large mound and things like that. So, or a deposit within that particular area. So visual inspection of sites can clearly bring to fore artifact and feature, and that can be recorded. That's how you're looking for archaeological exploration. Now, these are two pictures of how the site is. Now, this is a site explored in Kutch region by our department. You will notice that in the site, the soil color is rather ashy, and also on the surface, you notice pottery and other items lying scattered. And there will be also sites, if you properly explore, where sometimes the mud has been taken for agricultural activity. Now, here a canal was being dug, the mud has been removed, and here in the section of these cuttings, you can notice brick alignment. When such things, these alignment and things like that which you notice are basically called features. These are the things we call artifacts, and such man-made structures would be called as features. Now here also you will notice that there is a lot of stone scattered around here, but there is also a stone placed in an alignment, like as though it's part of a collapsed brick wall. So these are the features which we will be actually looking forward while surveying and walking around in the field, looking for artifacts and features. Now in Junakatiya in Kutch region, in explorations done by Dr. Rajesh and his team from our department, they were able to observe certain features all along the banks of a nala, where you could notice stone heaps and mounds being placed that it was practiced in burial grounds. So now, considering this to be an Harappan or pre-Harappan burial ground, from the artifacts that was found from the vicinity, excavations were conducted in this particular Junakatiya village. And in the excavations that were undertaken, pre-Harappan burials, sometimes in this burial chamber only it was symbolic burials that was there. Sometimes you have also found extended intact skeletons along with funerary goods in the burial. So this site was actually located on the basis of information of the local village headman there, and also when examining the site, certain features denoting burials were noticed. There were also artifacts in the site, and ultimately leading to the excavation of the site, which has pushed back the antiquity of that area to pre-Harappan times on the burial records here. Now, similarly, when explorations were taken for survey of forts in Kerala, from the pictures of Google pictures of Kumbla Fort, there appeared to have been some buried structures along the interior of the particular fort. And this fort is generally believed to have been built by the Ikeri Nayakas who ruled from Karnataka. And during explorations, when we visited the site, there were actually mounds with lateritic structures, fallen tiles and other things noticed in the sink. There were also standing structures. So from the ground plan which was available, it looked like some structure, and it was decided to excavate this particular spot as part of the Forts of Kerala project. And when we excavated, a huge palace complex was recovered or brought to light from these ruins which were visible, or these features which were noticed externally. And this report is already published in the book Forts of Kerala, authored by me. Apart from this, other forts also have been dealt in this work. Now, scientific aids also can help in archaeological explorations. Remote sensing is one of the most popular ways to locate archaeological, and there can be active and passive modes in scientific aids. Active modes include aerial photo, and passive modes include aerial photography, and the passive modes, the active modes include geophysical survey or resistivity using methods like instruments like resistivity meters, magnetometer, radars, etc. So passive modes basically uses reflections and shadows emerging from features, and active mode uses one basically resistivity method of survey. Now aerial photography initially was developed during the First and Second World War, when the planes were used to locate army targets or military targets, and subsequently this was developed by G.O.S. Crawford when he was working in Palestine and things like that. He was also able to locate archaeological sites in this sort of photography, and which then subsequently developed it using balloons, kites, and today we have also drones also being used for this particular, apart from satellite imagery where you could take the photograph of very large sites. And in that, actually there are two things which we actually look forward. One is the crop marks and other is the shadow mark. Crop marks are actually when a large area is under cultivation, as like these in England and America and things like that. You notice that if there is actually a pit in the uniform otherwise uniform looking field, in that pit actually there will be deeper collections of soil and things like that, and the plants growing there will have deeper roots going, and they would actually, because of the nourishment they get from the soil below, they would grow larger. At the uniform level, if the level is uniform, they would all grow at the same height, but if there is a pit, there would be a tendency for the crops to grow larger in height. And if there is actually a buried structure on it, the soil above these metal structures would be rather limited, so hence the crop growing over buried structure would have a shallow growth because of the poor soil contents beneath it because of the structure. So when these are actually photographed from during morning, evening, and sunset time, when in even light, they can produce differences in color of the crops which are growing, and from there we can actually track out if there are buried structures, and then further explore it by other means. So shadow markings also is of a similar nature, where when the sun is towards in an angle, the photographs are taken using plane or balloon and things like that. And if the structure is elevated, if you have an elevated structure lying underground and which is not actually very clearly visible on the surface of it, if photographs are taken during morning or evening lights, these buried structures can actually give you shadow marks which can help in locating large fortifications and other structures, buried structures. So basically in aerial photography, crop marks and shadow marks are the two important features which are looked forward for. Resistivity survey is basically when you have electric resistivity or magnetometric resistivity or sonar resistivity. The basic principle is that you either pass an electric current or a magnetic wave into the soil, and then if there is some structure which is beneath the soil, then that structure would reflect the waves back more quickly than where the structures are not there. So this can be actually plotted through scientific means, and you can get an idea of the buried structures which are there. This is done normally after locating a site through means of aerial photography and things like that. So it becomes rather easy because you can't excavate a very large area because of shortage funds and things like that. But you can still have a picture of what is buried beneath the soil by using resistivity survey. Electric resistivity is also one of the common material means which is used today. Portable equipment is available with the easily transportable means where you can read these duplexes which are there. Magnetometer is also similarly where you hold a handheld instrument, and then the recordings or deviations and the fluctuations in the readings are noted, and then it is plotted into via computer, and you can know what are the buried structures. Instrument magnetometry can also sometimes reveal brick structures which are buried in situ. It can also locate ditches, pits, hearths, or burnt structures also can be located due to this magnetometric method of survey. Now, electromagnetic sunray, ground penetrating radars, they all basically have the, or sonars also, they basically have the same character, that an impulse is sent into the ground and its deviation back from that ground is recorded. And if there's a buried structure, there would be deviation in the, or there would be a fluctuation in the uniformity of the reading that is obtained. And this can help us in tracing underground and buried structures. Now, once this is done, there can also be, coming to historical period sites, it can be also by reading, by reading into ancient texts, travel logs, old maps, etc. Old maps, Putanga tables is one of the oldest maps, the original dating to around 2nd century AD, where you have Blinka, which is identified with Vilnium, then you have Musiris and temple for Augustus, Tundis, all these located along the Malabar coast, recorded in this particular map. This is a large size map. There can be also small size. This is a small size map. There are, can be also large size map where a particular area itself is recorded. This is a map dating from 1505 of the Portuguese in Cochin, where many of the structures are actually labeled by name, and so that you can actually find out what are the structures there existing today and what was existing in time in 1500. So maps can be used, and when Alexander Cunningham actually started his exploration activity after taking up the post in archaeological survey of India, he relied on the travelogues of Fahien and Huansang, which were translated into French, and then conducted the exploration. So similarly, you can use maps as well as travelogues. Some of the old maps where you notice that the whole of the area from Kollam to Cochin, the western part is all demarcated as islands, and this is a feature which you would not notice if you're traveling today. And taking travelogues or Sandesha Kavyam into consideration, Mohsin Mohammed, a student of mine, had actually explored the travel loop mentioned in Unnineli Sandesham, and apart from confirming that the route which is mentioned in Unnineli Sandesham is very factually also recorded in Unnineli Sandesham, and along the way he was able to also find out many antiquarian structures, markets, inscriptions by taking this travelogue and exploring the route from Padmanabhaswamy temple, from where the main character moves to Kaduthurthi. So this work is actually a factual account of the travel route that was actually traversed by the main protagonist of this particular work. Now, excavations are actually removal of, once site is, any excavation is actually destruction. So excavation is actually basically removal of deposited layers in order to search for vestiges, and removal is actually in the reverse nature of their accumulation. So once you take up this action, it is irreversible. Once you dig something, you cannot put the material into the same place again. So all excavations are actually destruction unless you properly systematically record it. And in India and in many of the other countries also, excavation requires permission. And in India, it requires permission of the Archaeological Survey of India. And any excavation without attempting to informing federal authorities, whether it is the collector or the archaeological department, is actually illegal in fact. And early excavations were started in Europe by antiquarian artifacts, and the importance was for antiquarian artifacts and not for recording the find. It is Pitt Rivers who started, you know, recording the activities during excavations, in which was conducted in his own land in the late 19th century, and brought out the importance of documentation of artifacts from the context itself. And Flinders Petrie also, in his excavation in Egypt and Middle East, developed this methodology further, and he also brought out the importance of stratigraphic method, and he also brought out the importance of relative dating through typological study of pottery from various sites. And Mortimer Weiner, who started of the School of Archaeology in England, subsequently moved as Director General of Archaeological Survey of India. He was also aware of these activities which were happening, and he had viewpoints of both Pitt Rivers and Petrie collected together, and he emphasized the importance of stratigraphic context of material which are found from excavations. And he developed a method which was known as the square grid method, where sections are retained in one of the sites. And he also brought in three-dimensional recording methods. And the method which Wheeler implemented in India was done in Arkhamedu and Brahmagiri and things like that. And that system of excavations, he trained a lot of archaeologists in this method. And even the Archaeological Survey of India continues to follow the tradition which was followed by Wheeler. And the trenching methods in archaeological excavations, vertical trenching, step trenching, horizontal trenching, quadrant trenching, and Harris matrix method is the common methods which I use. But in every all these trenching styles also, basically it's the removal of the depositional rail in a stratigraphical sequence that is emphasized upon. Now this is known as the vertical trenching, where trenches are laid in a single line in the northwest or axis, and then the trenches are dug from top to bottom. This is actually horizontal. The similar, some people even attempt to do it in a stairway type of formations. Also, some people try to attempt it. The same type of vertical trenching. Horizontal is a trench where it is a larger area is covered, and the trenching covered is also, this is also the horizontal method is also known as area excavation, where a large area is actually laid out in trenches, and you actually go about digging the trenches, and between the trenches you try to maintain a bog or a stratigraphic sequence to understand the structures and which are being brought out in this particular formations. This is the quadrant method, whether it can be also, you lay a trench in square fashion and then dig two trenches simultaneously and then bring out. This is actually normally accepted in or easily done in structures which are actually exteriorly visible, like megaliths or stupas. This method is more easily done. Now, in all the excavations, stratigraphy plays an important role. Stratigraphy is a principle which has been borrowed from geology. As you know, the geological earth frame runs into millions of years, and we know that the earth's stratigraphical sequence has been divided into Paleozoic, Mesozoic, and Cenozoic. And I think many of you would be aware of the Jurassic period, which comes in the Mesozoic era, and then the Cenozoic. And Cenozoic, the last of its Cenozoic is Holocene. It's also the period which started around 10,000 years before, and it's even current vogue. And Pleistocene and Pliocene is the ones which precedes the Holocene. And it's during Pliocene, Pleistocene that humans emerge into the field. And these are also studied by according to the fossil remains that have been found from various strata. So the Earth's surface is being layered, or it has taken millions of years to evolve, and they are found in different layers. And so the formation of layers over the period of time is also taken as a principle for archaeological stratification. When you are excavating a site, humus is the first layer at the top, and then as we dig down into either the virgin soil or water level, we go by digging. This is the modern ones, followed by the ones. So 1, 2, 3, 4 are up to 12 are the number of layers, and the oldest layers would be at the bottom. And the oldest culture also would be towards the bottom, followed by the ones subsequent to it, it moves upwards. And stratigraphy is something like, you know, if you arrange a month's paper together, how would it be? The paper that has come on the first of the month would be at the bottom, followed by the paper arriving in the middle of the month would be in the center, and the paper which arrived in 30th or 31st of the month would be at the top. So it's something like that the older formations would be towards the bottom and the modern ones would be towards the top. Now in excavations, whatever trenching method you use, while the trenches are being dug, in a few centimeters a dig is undertaken, and then the material is collected, sorted. In first visual inspection, the material that emerges have been collected and sorted. Further, they can be sorted and sieved also. And after sieving, it can be either dry sieved to collect the material which are emerging from that dig which has been undertaken. And it can also be done through wet sieving, where different types of sieves are used. The larger ones at the top, smaller ones if they escape, they can be collected in smaller sieves which are there at the bottom. And once this is done, we can also collect the material which floats, like grains and other things, can be collected through wet sieving, and they can be used to date and also understand the food habits of humans. So wet sieving or dry sieving can be done in order to collect artifacts. Once the artifact is collected at the site itself, the measurement and drawings are undertaken of the site proper, and also the sectional drawing is undertaken, and material also are drawing with a scale at the bottom, trying to show the thickness of the vessel, the shape of the vessel. These are drawings done from each stratum, they are drawn, and it can be also photographed with a scale. Sometimes you can attach the photographs and the material together and also create a chart. And once all these material artifacts are analyzed, zoo artifacts, botanical artifacts and other cultural artifacts, once they are analyzed, they are brought out in a report and published, so that the public will know about what has been excavated and what has been done over the period. We in our department also carried archaeological explorations and excavations. Our site was basically, we focused on Vilnium, and Vilnium is a town which is known as the capital of Malainide from inscription, and it was also known as the capital of the I dynasty. And there are many inscriptions, especially copper plate gans like Velvur Kudi gans, Sirvamangalam gans, Dalavipuram gans, Sirvalangadu copper plates of Chola period, which states that Vilnium was a city. And there was also a fort which had sea water for its moat. But where exactly this fort was located, because this fort has been mentioned in all these copper plates which I just mentioned above, and where exactly was this location of this fort was basically unknown until we started inquiring into the fort remains at Vilnium. So it is also recorded in Pandya and Chola inscriptions that Vilnium was ransacked very frequently by these forces, and lot of wealth was taken from Vilnium to Tamil Nadu by Pandya and Chola rulers ruling in the Coromandel coast. Now, what exactly was the cause of this richness of Vilnium was not really expressed in these inscriptions, or what why exactly was this, how Vilnium sustained all these invasions and how it grew back into prominence during short periods of time was really not known. And what instigated our interest was that if such a fort, which is described as very high walls reaching the sky and moat for its filled with seawater, it definitely should have stood up in Vilnium somewhere. And our explorations was basically targeted at trying to trace this fort. Now, once we started trying to trace, we went about looking for place names, and we noticed that Madilpuram was once place, and there were also other places like Marindukota, which was actually located close to Vilnium. But since sea water was used in its moat, it should have been very close to the sea. So that is how we ventured into it. And the Vilnium's previous history has already been worked upon and it was meant, it was thought to be Balita, which is mentioned in the Greco-Roman periplus of the, in Greco-Roman work, periplus of Eurythmy, Balita is mentioned with the, as a village with a deep sea close by, and which perfectly matches with Vilnium. And there were also still standing rocket temples and ancient temples in the Lakati, which were already studied by different scholars. And there are also inscriptions with state of Vilnium, and the chief's arm maker, arms maker of the Aya kings is supposed to have hailed from Vilnium. There are also inscriptions from temples where traders from Vilnium had made donations. And Rajaraja Chola in his inscriptions takes credit for having destroyed Kandalur and the ships harboring in the port close to it. So basically these these inscriptions and things point out that Vilnium continued to be an important port as far as 13th century, because in Vilnium was known as Kolothunga Solapattam in 13th century inscription. So Pattanam definitely indicates that it had flourished as, or it had retained its status as a important port town at least in 13th century. Now this is the Peutinga table which mentions Blinka, which is supposed to be Vilnium, but we did not have archaeological artifacts of very early historic period coming from Vilnium to support these presumptions which were raised before. There are temples, rocket temple, and also structural temples at Vilnium close to the harbor area. This temple, which was of under the governor, there was some board, had a large tree growing in with a lot of complaints pouring in, and the tree was finally cut down, but the tree root held together this temple at that point of time. But however, after its the tree being cut down, tree again grew, and in 2 months back this particular temple completely collapsed at Vilnium, which was under the Devasam board. So we have lost a temple. There were also some old mosques which were in that area, Vilnium, which was also pulled down. There was also an old church, because we have an inscription affixed on the walls of this particular made dating to 1813, and this is a new church which has come up close to the harbor. Now, looking for the fort, first thing we went to about it, looking for the places which are in, ends with Kota, or we found 2-3 places in Vilnium where we had this reference to Kota. There was a place called Kotapuram where this church was located. We examined the area in depth, and we noticed that many of the structures there are only of medieval period and European period, and we could not notice any other earlier structure. So we went around looking for an area close to the sea which could have been an island-like formations, and that finally emerged when we visited this area known as Madalagam, Madalpuram, and also Marindukota. So this particular area, when we were initially trying to cross it, there was a slushy area in between this particular islandy formation and the landmass here. Now even today it is, this area remains a slush, and sea has entered this through this channel, and it comes back into this channel, pours back into the sea at the northern end. So this, in local people used to say that this particular area had remained isolated before a bridge coming up in the northern part where this channel goes and meets back into the sea. So this area was sent, taken up for exploration in depth, and during the explorations we were able to find out that along the seafront there were certain walls which were noticed. Now at the looking into the continuation of this wall, at the northwestern corner we were able to locate constructions of rubble masonry as well as lateritic stones in the northwestern corner, and beyond that it extended towards east where it was all covered by shrubs and bushes, and the department undertook clearance of this shrub and vegetations, and we were able to expose the ancient fortification at Vilnium, which dates to the 8th-9th century, or just the period of the IS. So this actually, for the first time, our explorations basing ourselves on the textual descriptions which are found, we were able to locate the forts of Aya period at Vilnium. And during the survey, we also noticed there were certain mounds which were located in Vilnium. And in order to understand the cultural sequence, we also excavated this particular site, Vilnium, for 3 seasons. We put around 7 to 8 trenches in different parts of Vilnium, and we were able to bring out very important artifacts from the excavations. And for the first time, we have been able to find roulette ware in the southern Kerala region. Roulette ware is a very significant pottery dating to around 1st century, 2nd century AD, which was initially considered to be a Roman pottery by Wheeler, Venny, Alexander, Archimedes. Subsequent studies have shown that it's a typical Indian ware originating from the Bengal region and found mostly in the port towns. So very fine ware and rowletted pottery has been reported for the first time. And this has also been established by carbon 14 dating methods in Vilnium. The earliest date go to around 3rd century AD in Vilnium, clearly bringing to the fact that Vilnium was habited during the 3rd century AD or 3rd century CE, and which also actually brings forth that the early descriptions which in existing Greco-Roman literature or in the Plutarch's tables would be true if we were able to consider that Vilnium could be Valita or Brinca mentioned in Plutarch's tables, because we have a date of carbon 14 date of 3rd century AD from Vilnium, and also we have artifacts from that particular region attesting this early historic antiquity. Larger materials were of dating to around 7th, 8th and 9th century period. We have torpedo jars, which is a West Asian pottery which is found along coastal belts in coastal towns of Kerala, and this has a bitumen coating inside. It is considered it was used for importing fish sauce and wine and things like that. What is interesting is it's shaped like a the torpedo, and then hence deriving its name. So the fuse or the basal point of this particular torpedo jar and mother shards have been found from Vilnium with bitumen coating inside, clearly attesting of the West Asian contact which was established at Vilnium. There are also turquoise gleamed pottery from Vilnium recovered in large quantities, which could have been pieces of such jars which were exchanged during trade from West Asia. And apart from these two elements, we were also able to find a large number of Chinese pottery from Vilnium, and the earliest of it are the Shanza ware, which date from 9th century. And these are from the Huang province in China, and these are the Shanza ware, which was for the first time reported from Vilnium. And this is the earliest Chinese porcelain known from Kerala, is from Vilnium, which dates to 9th century. Nowhere along the coastal line of Kerala, which had trade relations with China, Shanza ware of such magnitude or such numbers have not been found. And so the Shanza ware dating to 9th century clearly shows that the Ayas had established, Aya dynasty was at the paramount power during 9th century, and they also had established trade relations with the Chinese and the West Asian community. So this is the close-up of the Shanza pottery. These are actually plates. The brown color which you notice at four corners is an important feature of these Shanza ware plates. These have been reported from the Sumatran region, and Shanza pottery is an important pottery from Vilnium. These are actually sprouted jars which are there. These are the original structure, and what we have found is that fragments of these decorations which you notice on the Shanza jar has been found, the handles have been found, and also the spouts of Shanza ware has been reported from Vilnium for the first time. And the 9th century AD also corresponds with the powerful reign of the Ayas at Vilnium. And we have also obtained carbon 14 dating from certain layers, which also gives us a date of 8th, 9th century for the habitation and the pottery remains. These are actually Chinese porcelain dating from 11th to around 17th century. By the 16th century, the Portuguese had arrived and subsequent to Portuguese, the Dutch and the British also arrived. So we will, they also have had brief stints with Wilhelm, and the Dutch pottery here, it is clearly written that it is made in Holland, and such plates, these are actually fragments of such plates which are imported from Dutch. We have also British transfer ware reported from there. So these foreign pottery is actually very minuscule of the large number of Indian or local wares which we found at Wilhelm. The typical fish pot, which is even currently used in the same shape, is used even today. So the foreign wares actually show that we had trade relations. Apart from that, we have also been able to find a large number of glass beads, or Indo-Pacific beads, as some people call them, and some are made of quartz and also chalcedony. These materials definitely not local; they have come from through trade and other means of exchange into Wilhelm. And glass objects like bangles, some utilitarian bottles, and things like that also have been found. Apart from glass objects, we have found traces of iron crucibles, iron nails, a stray shivalinga which was embedded in a wall there, tiles, lamps. Many other objects have also been found. And from the observation of the artifacts, it's clear that Wilhelm had trade contacts with the region extending from West Asia to Far East in China. This has not been mentioned in any epigraphical sources or in text which describe of Wilhelm. So the emerging facts that Wilhelm had trade relations with West Asia and China is only observed from the artifacts which we have found from excavations at Wilhelm. And that is something exactly new to the information. This is added upon the historical things which we have already known about in Wilhelm from inscriptions and epigraphical sources. And it was because of the trade that flourished from Wilhelm that it was constantly attacked by Pandyas and Cholas. Because in 8th century, Sulaiman says that if a shipping vessel anchored at a port, 1,000 dirhams had to be paid to the state exchequer or the king. So in 1,000 dirhams in 9th century or 8th century, you can imagine what a lot of wealth that would actually be creating, trade would be created. Apart from that, there was also exchanges and trade by local as well as foreign traders. So the amount of revenue generated through trade was a very important factor in this thing. So it was to capture these flourishing trade of China, from China and West Asia, that the Pandyas and Cholas actually invaded Wilhelm. And it's because of the Cholas attack that finally that the importance of Wilhelm was subdued, and the port of Kollam under the Vena chieftains starts to emerge. So the basic things that basically it was traded from Wilhelm used to be iron implements, because we have an inscription saying that the chief arms maker was a resident of Wilhelm, and the Chera iron or the iron from the Chera Empire was sought after even in during Roman times. So iron implements, spices, cloth, pearls, and other fishing products used to be some of the most lucrative things that was exported from Wilhelm. Apart from Wilhelm importing other materials of foreign trade also into its region, so trade played an important role in the rise of Wilhelm, and it was also one of the factors which destroyed Wilhelm, because it was plundered and looted by the Pandyas and Cholas who came in from the Coromandel coast. Now, for I thank acknowledgements and further reading, KCHR team, especially Karthikeyan Nair and Dr. Fasia, for inviting me to this lecture. Thanks to Robert Harding, with whom we started our excavations at Wilhelm, who was from Cambridge University, and my former colleagues, Dr. Sujana, Dr. Ambli, Dr. Rajesh, Dr. Abhin, Dr. Vinod, Dr. Preeta Nair, Dr. Sheena Viya, and Sri Ranjesh Lal, and former research assistants and students of the Department of Archaeology, for having worked with us as a team in many of our projects, exploration and excavations. Book for further reading, Archaeological Principles and Methods, and Archaeology and Introduction by Kevin Greve are two important books which you can further read on this matter. Thank you all for your patience. Stay safe, stay happy. Loka samasta sukhino bhavantu. Thank you one and all.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, yes. Michael Tharin, sir.
Professor Ajit Kumar, sir. Nanni parayanayittanu njan intervene cheyyunnathu.
Thank you so much, sir.
Prabhashanathilum adu pole thanne adithinte vilappetta samayam KCHR nu vendi chelavidikkan thayarayathinum iniyum KCHR inde mattu paripadikalumayittu koodi ബന്ധപ്പെടണം എന്ന് അഭ്യർത്ഥിക്കുകയാണ്.
താങ്ക് യു സോ മച്ച് സർ.
ഇനി ചോദ്യങ്ങളോ ചർച്ചകളോ ഇതിലേക്കോ കടക്കാം.
ഓക്കെ, താങ്ക് യു സോ മച്ച് സർ.
തരേൻ സാർ അങ്ങനെ അഭ്യർത്ഥിക്കേണ്ട, ഞാൻ ആൾറെഡി ബുക്ക് ചെയ്തിരിക്കുകയാണ് സാറിനെ. ഇതിന്റെ രണ്ടാം ഭാഗം ഒരു പ്രഭാഷണം കൂടി വേണമെന്ന് ഞാൻ ആവശ്യപ്പെട്ടിട്ടുണ്ട്. സാർ സമ്മതിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട്. അത് അടുത്ത ആഴ്ച ഒരു ദിവസം സമയം തരാന്നാ പറഞ്ഞത്. അതിപ്പോ ഒന്ന് സാറ് സാർ ഒന്ന് പറയാമെങ്കിൽ ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് സന്തോഷമാണ്. ഇപ്പൊ തന്നെ അനൗൺസ്മെന്റ് എല്ലാവരും പോവും.
അടുത്ത ആക്ച്വലി ശനിയാഴ്ച എനിക്ക് ഒരു ക്ലാസ് കൂടെ ഉണ്ട്. ഈ വരുന്ന ശനിയാഴ്ച ഒരു ക്ലാസ് കൂടെ ഉണ്ട്. അപ്പൊ അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് അടുത്ത
ചൊവ്വാഴ്ച അടുത്ത ചൊവ്വാഴ്ച ആറാം തീയതി പറ്റുമോ?
ആ അടുത്ത ചൊവ്വാഴ്ച, അടുത്ത ബുധനാഴ്ച പറ്റുമെങ്കിൽ.
മനസ്സിലായല്ലോ നമ്മുടെ രീതി, പിടിച്ചാൽ പിന്നെ വിടുകയല്ല, ഉടുമ്പിനെ പോലെ പിടിക്കും.
ശരി ശരി, താങ്ക് യു.
സാർ ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട് സാർ. ജയജി നായർ ആണ് ചോദിച്ചിരിക്കുന്നത്. ഇസ് ആർക്കിയോളജി റെലവന്റ് ഇൻ ഡിസ്കവറിങ് മോഡേൺ ഹിസ്റ്ററി? മോഡേൺ ഹിസ്റ്ററി,
മോഡേൺ ഹിസ്റ്ററി
സാർ കംപ്ലീറ്റ് ആയിട്ടില്ല ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ. ഇൻ സ്ട്രാറ്റിഗ്രാഫി ഹൗ ഇസ് ദ ഡെപ്ത് ഓഫ് each layer defined?
First thing, archaeology can be helpful in understanding historical periods also, because of the simple fact that historical periods ile kittuna records ile palappolum rajabharanathekkuneyo rajavinte achievements ne kurichokke irikkum palappolum reekapaduthittundavu. Common man inde history enna chalappa reekapaduthittundavilla. അങ്ങനത്തെ ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള സൈറ്റ്സ് കിട്ടുകയാണെങ്കിൽ നമ്മളത് എക്സ്കവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്നതിൽ ത്രൂ നമ്മളെ ലോക്കൽ ആയിട്ടുള്ള ഹിസ്റ്ററി കൂടെ നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാനായിട്ടുള്ളൊരു അവസരം ഉണ്ടാക്കാണ്. കോമൺ മാൻസ് ഹിസ്റ്ററി കൂടെ നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ, ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ പീരീഡിലെ തന്നെ ആണെങ്കിൽ പോലും കോമൺ മാനിന്റെ ഹിസ്റ്ററി നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാനായിട്ട് എക്സ്കവേഷൻസ് ഓഫ് ആർ ഹിസ്റ്റോറിക്കൽ സൈറ്റ്സിൽ നിന്ന് നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ പറ്റും. സോ അത് ഡെഫിനറ്റ് ആയിട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റുന്നതാണ്. പിന്നെ സ്ട്രാറ്റഗ്രാഫി സീക്വൻസസ് എന്ന് പറയുന്നത് ഞാൻ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞു, മേലെ നിന്നാണ് നമ്മൾ കുഴിച്ചു കുഴിച്ച് താഴോട്ട് പോകുന്നത്, ഓരോ ലെയർ ആയിട്ടാണ് പോകുന്നത്. ഈച്ച് ലെയർ ഹാസ് ഇറ്റ്സ് ഓൺ ക്യാരക്ടർ. അത് കൾച്ചറൽ മെറ്റീരിയൽ വൈസ് ആയിരിക്കും, സോയിലിന്റെ ആ മെറ്റീരിയൽ പാർട്ടിക്കിൾസിന്റെ സംഭവമായിരിക്കും. അങ്ങനെ വ്യത്യസ്തമായിട്ടുള്ള ക്യാരക്ടർ ഓരോ ലെയറിൽ കാണിക്കുമ്പോഴാണ് ഓരോ ലെയറും നമ്മൾ മാറ്റി നിർത്തുന്നത്. ആ ലെയറിന്റെ തിക്നെസ് അക്കോർഡ് ഇറ്റ് വിൽ ബി ഓൺ ദ നേച്ചർ ഓഫ് ദ ഡിപ്പോസിറ്റ്. കൂടുതൽ ഡിപ്പോസിറ്റ് അല്ലെങ്കിൽ കൂടുതൽ പീരീഡ് ഒരു ഹാബിറ്റേഷൻ ഒരിടത്ത് നിന്ന് കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ആ ലെയറ് കൂടുതൽ തിക്നെസ് ഉള്ള ലെയർ ആയിട്ട് മാറും. ചിലയിടത്ത് ആ ഓരോ ഹാബിറ്റേഷൻ കഴിഞ്ഞ് ചിലപ്പോൾ ഓരോ ഹാബിറ്റേഷൻ അബാൻഡൻ ചെയ്ത് പോയി കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ ഇതിന്റെ മേലെ വരുന്ന ലെയർ നമ്മൾ സ്റ്റെറൈൽ ലെയർ എന്നായിരിക്കും വിളിക്കുന്നത്. ആ ലെയറിനകത്ത് നമുക്ക് ബേസിക് ആയിട്ട് മെറ്റീരിയൽ ഒന്നും കിട്ടാതെ വരും. അപ്പൊ അത് സ്റ്റെറൈൽ ആയിട്ട്, അപ്പൊ ആ സ്റ്റെറൈൽ ലെയറിന്റെ അർത്ഥം അവിടെ ഹാബിറ്റേഷൻ ആ കാലഘട്ടത്തിൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നില്ല എന്നുള്ളതും നമുക്ക് മനസ്സിലാക്കാൻ പറ്റും. സോ തിക്നെസ് ഓഫ് ദ ഡിപ്പോസിറ്റ് ഡിപ്പെൻഡ്സ് ഓൺ ദ ടൈം ഫോർ വിച്ച് ദാറ്റ് സൈറ്റ് കണ്ടിന്യൂ ടു റിമെയിൻ ഹാബിറ്റഡ്. കൂടുതൽ നാളെ ഹാബിറ്റഡ് ആണെങ്കിൽ കൂടുതൽ തിക്നെസ്സിൽ നമുക്ക് ഡിപ്പോസിറ്റ് കിട്ടും.
സാർ വേറെ ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻസ് ഒന്നും വന്നിട്ടില്ല.
ഓക്കെ, താങ്ക് യു.
വൈൻഡ് അപ്പ് ചെയ്യാന്ന് വിചാരിക്കുന്നു സാർ. അതുപോലെ അടുത്ത ഡേറ്റ് കൺഫേം ആവാത്തതുകൊണ്ട് നമ്മൾ അനൗൺസ് ചെയ്യുന്നില്ല. മൈക്കിൾ തരൻ സാർ എന്തോ പറയുന്നു സാർ.
ഹലോ, ഡേറ്റ് കൺഫേം ആയി, പേരാന്തി സാർ പറഞ്ഞിട്ടുണ്ടല്ലോ. ടെക്നോളജി ആയിരിക്കും നമ്മുടെ ഈ വസ്തുതകളുടെ കാലഗണനയായിരിക്കും സാറിന്റെ. ഞങ്ങൾ രാവിലെ ഫോണിൽ സംസാരിച്ചായിരുന്നു സാർ.
എനിക്ക് ഇപ്പൊ പ്രൊഫസർ അജിത് കുമാർ പറഞ്ഞതിനോട് ബന്ധപ്പെടുത്തി ഒരു കാര്യം പറയാനുള്ളത്, ഞാൻ ഒരു ആർക്കിയോളജിസ്റ്റ് ആയതുകൊണ്ടല്ല, എന്റെ പൊതുവായ ധാരണയിൽ നിന്നും വരുന്ന ഉദിക്കുന്ന ഒരു ഒരു സംഗതിയാണ്. ഇംഗ്ലീഷ് ഈസ്റ്റ് ഇന്ത്യ കമ്പനിയുടെ തുടക്കവും അതിൻ്റെ ആദ്യകാല ചരിത്രവും മനസ്സിലാക്കുന്നതിൽ ആർക്കിയോളജി അർബൻ ലണ്ടനിലെ അർബൻ ആർക്കിയോളജി വർക്ക് വളരെ ഉപകാരപ്രദമായിട്ടുണ്ട്. ഇപ്പോഴും ആ വർക്ക് നടന്നുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുകയാണെന്നുള്ളതാണ് എൻ്റെ ധാരണ. ഇവരുടെ ആദ്യകാലത്തെ ഗോഡൗണുകളെയും കെട്ടിടങ്ങളെയും കുറിച്ച് അതിൻ്റെ ബേസുകൾ കണ്ടുപിടിക്കുകയും അതിൻ്റെ പൊസിഷനുകൾ എവിടെയായിരുന്നു, ഏത് ഡയറക്ഷനിലായിരുന്നു എന്നൊക്കെ ഉള്ളതും, പിന്നെ പുതിയ പുതിയ കെട്ടിടങ്ങൾ വന്ന് അതിൻ്റെ മുകളിൽ വന്നപ്പോഴുണ്ടായിട്ടുള്ള മാറ്റങ്ങളെ കുറിച്ചുമൊക്കെ അർബൻ ആർക്കിയോളജി ആധുനിക കാലത്തെ അർബൻ ആർക്കിയോളജി സഹായിച്ചിട്ടുണ്ട് എന്നാണ് ഞാൻ മനസ്സിലാക്കിയിട്ടുള്ളത്. അത് കൂടുതൽ വ്യക്തമായിട്ട് പറയാൻ പ്രൊഫസർ അജിത് കുമാറിനും മറ്റുമായിരിക്കും പറയാൻ സാധിക്കുക. ഞാൻ എൻ്റെ വായനയിൽ കണ്ടിട്ട് കേട്ടിട്ടുള്ള ഒരു ഒരു സംഗതി പറഞ്ഞു എന്നേ ഉള്ളൂ.
സാറ് പറഞ്ഞത് ശരിയാണ്. ഈ ഏർബൻ ആർക്കിയോളജി എസ്പെഷ്യലി നമ്മൾ ബ്രിട്ടീഷ് പീരീഡ് തൊട്ട് ഇങ്ങോട്ട് എടുക്കുമ്പോഴത്തേക്കും പലരുടെയും ശ്രദ്ധ അതിൽ പതിഞ്ഞിട്ടില്ല. ഇന്ത്യയിൽ അറ്റ്ലീസ്റ്റ് അത് പതിഞ്ഞിട്ടില്ല. നമ്മള് ബ്രിട്ടീഷേഴ്സിൽ നിന്ന് ഒരു ഇൻഡിപെൻഡൻസ് കിട്ടി എന്ന് പറയുമ്പോഴത്തേക്ക് തന്നെ അവരുടെ ഒരു സംഭവം പലതും നമ്മള് ചിലതൊക്കെ ചില സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ ഇപ്പോഴും നമ്മള് കണ്ടിന്യൂസ് ആയിട്ട് യൂസ് ചെയ്ത് പോകുന്നുണ്ട്. പക്ഷേ എക്സെപ്റ്റ് ഫോർ ദ ഫാക്ട് ദാറ്റ് സമത് വളരെ പ്രൊമിനന്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള ചില സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സിനെ മാത്രമേ സ്റ്റഡി ലഭിച്ചിട്ടുള്ളൂ. ഇപ്പൊ അവരുടെ ഫോർട്സിനെ കുറിച്ച് യൂറോപ്യൻ കൊളോണിയൽ ഫോർട്സിനെ കുറിച്ച് ആൾക്കാര് ചിലർ സ്റ്റഡി ചെയ്തിട്ടുണ്ട്. പക്ഷെ പല സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സും യുനു ബിക്കോസ് ഓഫ് ദ വാർ സോണിൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്ന പലതും ഡിസ്ട്രോയ് ചെയ്ത് പോയി. പക്ഷെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടന്റ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള അവരുടെ ടൗൺസിനകത്ത് പോലും യുനു ദേ ഹാഡ് ദർ ക്യാപിറ്റൽ ടൗൺ ബ്ലാക്ക് ടൗൺ ജൂ അങ്ങനെയൊക്കെ ഉള്ള ഒരു രീതിയിലായിരുന്നു അവർ ജീവിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരുന്നത്. പലയിടത്തും ഇവരുടെ എക്സ്റ്റെൻസീവ് ആയിട്ടുള്ള അവരുടെ ഹാബിറ്റേഷന് ചുറ്റും ഉണ്ടായിരുന്ന ഫോർട്ടിഫിക്കേഷൻസ് ഒക്കെ ഇന്ന് നശിപ്പിച്ചു കളഞ്ഞിരിക്കുകയാണ്. സോ വി ഡു നോട്ട് നോ പഴയ സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ്. ഇപ്പം നമ്മുടെ ബ്രിട്ടീഷ് പീരീഡിലെ ഈവൻ നമ്മുടെ അഞ്ചുതെങ്ങ് ഫോർട്ടിൽ പോയാലോ അല്ലെങ്കിൽ നമ്മുടെ തലശ്ശേരി ഫോർട്ടിൽ പോയാലും വളരെ ഫ്യൂ സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ് ഉള്ളി ഓഫ് ബ്രിട്ടീഷ് പീരീഡ്. ആ ഫോർട്ടിഫിക്കേഷന്റെ എക്സ്റ്റേണൽ വാൾസ് അല്ലാതെ അതിനകത്തുള്ള സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ് ഒക്കെ വളരെ ലേറ്റ് പീരീഡിലൊക്കെ ഉള്ളത് തന്നെയാണ്. പക്ഷെ ഇതൊന്നും ആധികാരികമായിട്ട് ആരും പഠിച്ചിട്ടില്ലെന്നുള്ളതാണ് വളരെ ദുഃഖകരമായിട്ടുള്ള സംഭവം. ഇത് പഠിക്കാൻ പറ്റുന്ന ഒരു ടോപ്പിക്കാണ്, പക്ഷെ അതിന് ആർക്കിടെക്ചറും അതിന്റെ ഒരു ബേസിക് എന്താണ് അതിന്റെ ടെക്നിക്കൽ സൈഡ് കൂടെ എഞ്ചിനീയറിംഗ് ആസ്പെക്ട് കൂടെ നന്നായി മനസ്സിലാക്കിയെങ്കിൽ മാത്രമേ നമുക്ക് അങ്ങനത്തെ സ്റ്റഡീസ് വ്യാപകമായിട്ട് എടുക്കാൻ പറ്റുള്ളൂ. യൂറോപ്പില് ഈവൻ ലണ്ടൻ സിറ്റിയിൽ തന്നെ റോമൻ പീരീഡ് തൊട്ടുള്ള എവിഡൻസസ് നമുക്ക് ചില സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സിന്റെ ഒക്കെ റിനോവേഷൻ പീരീഡിൽ അതിന്റെ അണ്ടർടേക്ക് ചെയ്യുമ്പോഴത്തേക്കും അതിനകത്ത് നിന്ന് കിട്ടുന്നുണ്ട്. ഇപ്പം പലപ്പോഴും നമ്മുടെ ഇവിടെ ഒന്നും ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് ആക്ടിവിറ്റീസിന് നമ്മളൊരു ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ ക്ലിയറൻസസ് പല വലിയ വലിയ സിറ്റീസിൽ നിന്നും എടുക്കുന്നില്ല. പക്ഷേ ഇംഗ്ലണ്ടിൽ ഒക്കെ പല സിറ്റീസിലും നമ്മളൊരു ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ ഒരു പുതിയ ബിൽഡിംഗ് കെട്ടണമെങ്കിൽ അവിടുന്ന് ആ ഏരിയ എക്സ്കവേറ്റ് ചെയ്ത ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ മെറ്റീരിയൽ ഒന്നും ഇല്ല എന്നുള്ളത് സംഭവം അത് അവർക്ക് സർട്ടിഫൈ ചെയ്തെങ്കിൽ മാത്രമേ അവർക്ക് ആ ബിൽഡിംഗ് കൺസ്ട്രക്ട് ചെയ്യും. അതുകൊണ്ടാണ് ചില സമയത്തൊക്കെ നമ്മൾ കേൾക്കുന്ന ചിലയിടത്ത് ബെറിയൽസ് കണ്ടെത്തി അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ചിലപ്പോൾ വാറിന്റെ മെറ്റീരിയൽ കണ്ടെത്തി അല്ലെങ്കിൽ റോമൻ പീരീഡിലെ മെറ്റീരിയൽ കണ്ടെത്തി എന്നൊക്കെ കേൾക്കുന്ന പത്രങ്ങളിൽ ഇറ്റ്സ് ബിക്കോസ് ദാറ്റ് ആ ഏരിയ ഈ പുതിയ സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സ് വരണതിന് മുമ്പേ അവർ ആർക്കിയോളജിസ്റ്റ് അത് പഠിച്ചിട്ട് അതിനൊരു നോ ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ ക്ലിയറൻസ് കൊടുക്കുന്നതാണ്. ഇങ്ങനത്തെ സംഭവം ഒന്നും ഇപ്പം ഇന്ത്യയിൽ നിലവില്ല. ഇപ്പൊ ഇവിടെ ഹെറിറ്റേജ് സ്ട്രക്ചേഴ്സിന് ചുറ്റുമുള്ള സ്ഥലം തന്നെ ഇനോ ആൾക്കാർ ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് നടക്കുന്നില്ല എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ് പ്രതിഷേധിക്കുന്ന ഒരു കാലഘട്ടത്തിലാണ് നമ്മൾ ഇപ്പൊ ഈ ഫോർട്ട് കൊച്ചിയിലൊക്കെ പുതിയ പഴയ ബിൽഡിങ്സ് റിനോവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യണമെങ്കിൽ പലപ്പോഴും പെർമിഷൻസ് കൊടുക്കാറില്ല എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ ആൾക്കാർ പ്രൊട്ടസ്റ്റ് ചെയ്യുന്ന ഒരു സംഭവമാണ് ഇപ്പൊ നമ്മൾ കാണുന്നത്. അപ്പം പലപ്പോഴും ഈ ബിൽഡിങ് പോയി കിട്ടിയാൽ സുഖം എന്നുള്ള രീതിയിലാണ് പലപ്പോഴും ആൾക്കാർ വീക്ഷിക്കുന്നത്. സോ അതൊക്കെയാണ് പ്രോബ്ലംസ്. ഇപ്പം
ഒരു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട് സർ.
ആ പറയൂ.
അനീഷ് സത്യനാണ് ചോദിക്കുന്നത്. എനി റീസന്റ് ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ് ഇൻ ലൊക്കേറ്റിംഗ് കാന്തളൂർശാല?
കാന്തല്ലൂർ ശാല എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞു കാന്തല്ലൂർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് ആക്ച്വലി ഒരു ഒരു സൈറ്റ് ഒരു വില്ലേജ് ഉണ്ട് വിഴിഞ്ഞത്തിൽ നിന്ന് കുറച്ചുകൂടെ മാറിയിട്ട് ടുവേർഡ്സ് നേട്ടങ്കര സൈഡിലേക്ക് വരും. അപ്പൊ അവിടെ ഞങ്ങളൊരു എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ നടത്തിയായിരുന്നു. ആ എക്സ്പ്ലോറേഷൻ ചെയ്തതിന്റെ ഭാഗമായിട്ട് ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് അവിടുന്ന് അയൺ ഇൻഗോട്ട്സും പോട്ടറിയും ബെറിയൽ ജാർസും ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് കിട്ടിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. അത് ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് കഴിഞ്ഞ പ്രാവശ്യം ഞങ്ങൾക്കത് പെർമിഷൻ കിട്ടുകയും ചെയ്തു. അവിടെ എക്സ്കവേഷൻ ചെയ്യാൻ വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് പെർമിഷൻ കിട്ടുകയും ചെയ്തു. പക്ഷെ അതിൻ്റെ ഇടയ്ക്കാണ് ഞങ്ങളുടെ ടീം ഇവിടുന്ന് ഗുജറാത്തിൽ പോയിട്ട് അവിടെ ഈ കോവിഡിന്റെ കാരണം ഞങ്ങൾക്ക് അവിടെ അവർക്ക് അവിടെ തന്നെ നിൽക്കേണ്ടി വന്നത്. അല്ലെങ്കിൽ ഈ സീസണിൽ ഞങ്ങളത് ആ കാന്തല്ലൂർ ഷാട്ട എക്സ്കവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യുക, കാന്തല്ലൂർ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞ വില്ലേജ് എക്സ്കവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാൻ ആർക്കിയോളജിക്കൽ സർവേ ഓഫ് ഇന്ത്യ ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെന്റിന് പെർമിഷൻ കിട്ടിയതായിരുന്നു. ഡോക്ടർ പ്രീതയ്ക്ക് പെർമിഷൻ കിട്ടിയതായിരുന്നു കാന്തല്ലൂർ ഷാട്ട എക്സ്കവേറ്റ് ചെയ്യാനായിട്ട്. പക്ഷെ അത് നടത്തി എക്സ്കവേഷൻ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റിയില്ല. ബട്ട് ഡെഫിനറ്റ്ലി ആ പെർമിഷൻ ഉള്ളിടത്തോളം കാലം നമ്മളത് പിന്നെയും അത് കോവിഡിന്റെ ഒരു സിറ്റുവേഷൻ മാറിക്കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഞങ്ങൾ അത് എക്സ്കവേഷൻ ചെയ്യണം എന്ന് തന്നെയുള്ള ധാരണയിലാണ്. അവിടെ ഒരു ഒരു കുട്ടി അതിനെ കുറിച്ച് റിസർച്ചും ചെയ്യുകയുണ്ടായി കാന്തല്ലൂർ ഷാലയെ കുറിച്ച്. അപ്പം ഷീ ഹാസ് ഓൾസോ ബീൻ ഏബിൾ ടു ബ്രിങ് ഔട്ട് യു നോ സർട്ടൻ ഏൻഷ്യന്റ് ആർട്ടിഫാക്ട്സ് ഫ്രം ദാറ്റ്. ആ കുട്ടിയുടെ റിസർച്ചിൽ നിന്നാണ് പിന്നെ ഞങ്ങൾ അവിടെ വെഞ്ചർ ചെയ്തത്. സ്റ്റഡീസ് ഉണ്ട്, ഞങ്ങൾ എക്സ്കവേഷൻ ചെയ്യാൻ പെർമിഷൻ കിട്ടിയിട്ടുണ്ട്, പക്ഷെ ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല എന്നുള്ളതാണ്, ഈ കോവിഡ് കാരണം ചെയ്യാൻ പറ്റില്ല.
ഓക്കേ, താങ്ക്യൂ സർ.
താങ്ക്യൂ സർ,
ചോദ്യങ്ങളില്ല. അപ്പം അടുത്ത ആഴ്ച കാണാം സർ. കാർത്തികേയൻ സർ എന്താ പറയുന്നു?
വീണ്ടും നമുക്ക് കാണാം, കാണണം ആവശ്യമുണ്ട്. കാരണം ഞാനും സാറും ഒക്കെ ഇപ്പൊ താമസിക്കുന്ന തിരുവനന്തപുരം ജില്ലയിലെ സാർ നേരത്തെ സൂചിപ്പിച്ച പോലെ ഇങ്ങനെ നമ്മൾ ചരിത്രത്തിൽ കാർക്കിച്ചു തുപ്പുകയും മലമൂത്ര വിസർജനം ചെയ്യുകയും ചെയ്യുന്ന അവസ്ഥ എത്തിയിട്ടുണ്ട്. നമ്മുടെ പുരാവസ്തുക്കളെ നമുക്ക് സൂക്ഷിക്കുന്ന കാര്യത്തിൽ യാതൊരു ബോധവും ഇല്ലാതെയാണ് കേരളീയർ പെരുമാറുന്നത് എന്നുള്ളത് വലിയ തെളിവ് പറഞ്ഞല്ലോ. സാറിന് അറിയാമായിരിക്കും, നമ്മുടെ സാറിന്റെ സഹപ്രവർത്തകൻ രാജേന്ദ്രൻ, ഡോക്ടർ രാജേന്ദ്രൻ പെരുമ്പളയിലുള്ള പാണ്ഡവം പാറയിലെ എക്സ്കവേഷൻ, ആ എക്സ്കവേഷൻ ഇപ്പോ ഏതാണ്ട് വഴിമുട്ടി നിൽക്കുക. കാരണം രണ്ട് പാറയെ പൊട്ടിച്ചു കഴിഞ്ഞു കോറിക്കാർ. അത് പാറ ഇപ്പൊ വലിയ അപകടാവസ്ഥയിൽ നിൽക്കുകയാണ്. അപ്പോ എടക്കൽ ഗുഹയുടെ അത്രയും പഴക്കം ഉണ്ട് എന്ന് വിചാരിക്കുന്ന ചില രേഖകളൊക്കെ അവിടെ ഉണ്ട്. ഡോക്ടർ രാജേന്ദ്രന്റെ പഠനങ്ങളും വന്നിട്ടുണ്ട്. പക്ഷെ അതിപ്പോ അപകടാവസ്ഥയില്ല. കാരണം രാജ്യം വികസിക്കണമെങ്കിൽ പാറ വേണം, വിഴിഞ്ഞം തുറവും വേണമെങ്കിലും പാറ വേണം. പക്ഷെ പാറ പൊട്ടിഞ്ഞാൽ നമ്മുടെ പൈതൃകം പോകും. അപ്പൊ പാറയും പൈതൃകവും നമ്മളും കൂടിയാണ് പേറ്റുമുട്ടിക്കൊണ്ടിരിക്കുന്നത്. എന്തായാലും സാർ സന്തോഷം സാർ. സാറ് അടുത്ത ഡേറ്റിംഗ് ടെക്നോളജിയെ കുറിച്ചുകൂടെ ഒക്കെ പറയുമല്ലോ. അപ്പോ കുറച്ചുകൂടി നമുക്കും മുതിർന്നവർക്കും ഒക്കെ ഇത് പ്രയോജനകരമായിരിക്കും. ഒരിക്കൽ കൂടി കെ സി എച്ച് ആറിന് വേണ്ടി നന്ദി രേഖപ്പെടുത്തുന്നു. വീണ്ടും കാണാം അടുത്ത ബുധനാഴ്ച വൈകിട്ട് 3 മണിക്ക്.
Thank you, sir.